For some species, extinction in the wild isn't the end. Even when a frog or a bird has completely vanished from its natural habitat, sometimes there is still hope of saving it. Scientists keep insurance populations of endangered animals in safe spots all over the world with the goal of reintroducing them one day. But they're not just herding the creatures together with their fingers crossed. A lot of fascinating research is being done on the threats these animals face and what they need to survive. You're about to meet a few of the most endangered species on Earth. Some have essentially been gone from the wild for years, but luckily, some scientists refused to allow a little problem like extinction to get in the way of a good conservation story. This episode was made in partnership with Wild Hope. Wild Hope is a series of short, free documentaries right here on YouTube that bring you stories about scientists and changemakers who are restoring our wild places and sparking new hope for the future of our planet's biodiversity. Let's start with the Panamanian golden frog. It is a tiny, brightly colored animal native to Panama's rainforest, and fun fact, it is not actually a frog. It is a toad. These toads have been extinct in the wild for a while now. At least that's what scientists suspect. The last time they spotted one was back in 2009, but the jungle is a big place and researchers still hope to find a few out there somewhere. This near extinction happened for a variety of reasons, but one major cause is a nasty fungal infection called chytridiomycosis. The chytrid fungus affects amphibians, first infecting the outer layer of the animal's skin and then eventually causing symptoms such as convulsions, abnormal feeding, and death. Fungi can be kind of gruesome sometimes. This infection isn't species specific, and has been observed all over the world on every continent except Antarctica. But it has hit some species harder than others. And the Panamanian golden frog got the worst of it. A species that used to be so common in Panama that it is a cultural icon was wiped out in just a few years. Luckily, before that happened, conservationists gathered some of them and began breeding them in zoos all around the world. Then the Panama Amphibian Rescue and Conservation Project, or PARC, got involved. PARC not only participates in the breeding and caring for some of the golden frogs, they also are studying a variety of amphibians, hoping to learn more about how to protect them all from chytrid. That starts with getting the animals to reproduce in captivity, which is not always easy. So the team has turned to in vitro fertilization. That not only ensures enough little froggies for the selective breeding program, it also pumps up the number of frogs for controlled release experiments. Since the ultimate goal is to reintroduce the golden frog to the wild, researchers need to develop best practices for doing so. They tested two different methods of releasing a closely related species to golden frogs. Hard release, where the animals were let go instantly, and soft release, where they were kept in a contained section of their natural environment for 30 days before being freed into the wild. And they found that even though the hard-released frogs dispersed further, the soft-released animals were more likely to survive. And to make sure these efforts are truly global, the project trying to save the golden frog was created in partnership with multiple zoos like the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C., because it's never a good idea to keep all of the insurance populations in one spot. Which brings us to our next animal in need of help, the Tasmanian Devil. This little guy is not just a funny Looney Tunes character, it's an actual animal, and it looks nothing like the Looney Tunes character. Tasmanian Devils are the largest carnivorous marsupials in the world, and their name is not an exaggeration. They have fierce tempers and have been known to let out blood-curdling screams. In the wild, they're mostly found on the island state of Tasmania off the coast of Australia. They used to live all across the entire Australian continent, but when dingoes were introduced, the devils could not compete. That's right. Dingoes are not native to Australia. Tasmania doesn't have any dingoes, so the devils thrived there for a long time. And then, just like the frogs in Panama, they encountered a disease that threatened the entire population. Since the mid-90s, the number of Tasmanian devils has dropped by about 80%, in part due to a cancer called devil facial tumor disease, or DFTD. Tasmanian devils are particularly at risk for a contagious cancer because they don't have a lot of genetic diversity, meaning that each devil is genetically very similar to the others. Anytime an animal population lacks genetic diversity, a single disease can threaten the entire group if they all lack resistance to it. DFTD is contagious, and it spreads between individuals through biting, which is devilishly common in these animals. Tasmanian devils frequently bite each other during both mating and feeding. The disease is always fatal. It kills devils within 6 to 12 months of infection, and there is no cure or vaccination. vaccine. That led researchers to take Tasmanian devils that they were sure were free of the disease and move them to isolated insurance populations. The project started in 2006 and involves dozens of zoos where the animals are being raised in captivity. Because the Tasmanian devils didn't have much genetic diversity to begin with, and small insurance populations can compound that problem, researchers are working on breeding more of it into the group by using animals from different sites. The scientists have found some interesting things, like that it might be better for that purpose to select animals to mate and enforce monogamy, rather than housing them as a group and letting them choose for themselves. But while the devils in zoos are contained, another insurance population on nearby Maria Island has a bit more freedom. That, unfortunately, has revealed the challenge of keeping insurance populations in the wild. Maria Island is just off the coast of Tasmania. It was chosen because it's nearby and had plenty of prey for the devils, but it's far enough away that infected devils wouldn't be able to get in. Researchers released a couple of dozen devils onto Maria Island back in 2012, and the animals enjoyed complete freedom there. No fences, no anything. That freedom was fantastic for the devils. They thrived on Maria Island, with 28 of them in 2012 becoming 100 in 2016. But it was not so great for Maria Island's bird population. Before the devils were introduced, the island was home to about 3,000 breeding pairs of penguins. Now, penguins have all but disappeared there. This has spurred calls to remove the devils from the island, and highlights one big problem for uncontained insurance populations. When animals are set loose in an ecosystem that doesn't have a niche for them, they can become an invasive species themselves. The Tasmanian devil isn't the only endangered species that has caused a bit of controversy. Although in the case of our next animal, the controversy has popped up not about the insurance population, but about how we can make the wild safe for them to return to. Hawaii's birds are in trouble. A scary amount of Hawaii's native wildlife has become endangered or threatened over the past century. The major causes are habitat destruction as people settle there, invasive species from the mainland, climate change, and, you guessed it, disease. Climate change has been rough on some birds because it has allowed non-native mosquitoes to thrive at higher altitudes and introduce diseases like avian malaria into populations that were once disease-free. The Hawaiian akakika is a bird that has been hit particularly hard. The akakika is a type of honey creeper found only on the island of Kauai. These birds, which normally live at high altitudes, have started to struggle because of malaria brought in by mosquitoes that can now tolerate their environment. In 2023, there were only 5 akakikas left in the wild, down from nearly 50 in 2022. As such, the akakika is one of the most endangered birds in the United States. Luckily, the Maui Bird Conservation Center has been collecting fertilized eggs from these beauties in the hopes of conserving their population. The Maui Bird Conservation Center was formed by the San Diego Zoo Wildlife Alliance, and some of the birds housed there are completely extinct in the wild. Now, to protect against the possibility of disaster at the Kauai facility, conservationists were careful not to rely entirely on one location. The same bird species that live there can also be found at a partner location on the Big Island. In 2023, wildfires in Hawaii made it painfully clear why that precaution is necessary. The Maui location was almost swallowed up by the flames. 2 people, a conservation center worker and a brave neighbor, rushed to keep the fires at bay with hoses and fire extinguishers until the firefighters could show up to reinforce them. Luckily, all 40 akakikas there remain safe. The conservationists hope to hold the birds there until the mosquito threat can be taken care of. That, however, is easier said than done. Since the birds live at the top of a mountain, it's not like mosquito nets can be put up there to keep them safe. Instead, Hawaii is planning on taking drastic action. The government plans to release millions of specially bred male mosquitoes with a type of bacteria in their gut that effectively renders them sterile. Their hope is that these new males will mate with local females, which can only mate once in their lives. That could greatly cut back on the mosquito population. Now, male mosquitoes don't do the biting, so on paper that seems like a good plan, but it's received a lot of pushback from residents who fear that releasing thousands of altered mosquitoes into the environment could have unforeseen consequences and make things even worse. This led to a lawsuit against the state of Hawaii, but that lawsuit only made it as far as the First Circuit Court before it was shut down. This method of controlling mosquitoes has been successful in places like China and Mexico, so the Hawaiian conservationists are encouraged. It looks like the mosquito project will go ahead there, but only time will tell if this will be enough to save the akakika and other birds like it. Our next endangered animal is is a favorite at zoos throughout the world. Golden lion tamarins are small social primates with reddish gold coats and swept back manes that could make Fabio jealous. They're native to a region in southeastern Brazil known as the Atlantic rainforest, one that's just as biodiverse as its neighbor, the Amazon. Golden lion tamarin populations took a massive hit in the 20th century due to habitat destruction. Their territories have been destroyed to make way for sugarcane and coffee production, cattle grazing, logging, and other developments. In the early 1970s, the tamarin population decreased to the point where there were only about 200 left in the wild. Zoos and other conservation programs quickly sprang into action. In 1972, more than 24 biologists from America, Europe, and Brazil came together to discuss how to save the tamarin. The solution? Insurance populations. A program was created at zoos all over the world with the goal of breeding enough of them in safety to reintroduce into the wild. At the same time, reforestation efforts continued in Brazil. In 1992, the Associação Micoleal Dourado, or AMLD, was established. In English, their name means the Golden Lion Tamarin Association. They focused on conserving the tamarin by preserving the forest they call home. After years of reforestation work, the zoos began to reintroduce their tamarins back to Brazil. And today, about a third of wild tamarins are descended from those breeding programs. And by all accounts, the AMLD has achieved its goal. In the 90s, the AMLD said that if they could have 2,000 tamarins living in 25,000 acres of protected forest habitats by 2025, they would be able to consider the species safe from extinction. In 2023, a tamarin census found that there were 4,800 tamarins living in the São João River Basin. And that's even after an outbreak of yellow fever in 2018 that required another intervention, a vaccine for the tamarin population adapted from the one used for humans. But there is one additional problem. While there are a lot of tamarins in the wild now, they don't live in connected habitats. Brazil's tamarin populations mostly live in isolated pockets of forests, basically little islands of greenery that are not connected to each other. That's led to a lot of concern about genetic diversity, with researchers worrying that tamarin populations in isolated areas could be in trouble again within a few generations. To solve this problem, Brazil's conservationists have started reforestation projects aimed at creating wildlife corridors, stretches of forest that connect isolated tamarin populations to each other. These corridors act as bridges for the tamarins, allowing them to safely travel from one biodiversity hotspot to another. Not only do those corridors help the tamarins, they can also be used by other wild species to cross from one section of forest to another. The tamarins are a great success story, showing how a species can be brought back even when there are only a few left. But our last endangered animal might have an even more dramatic tale, having come back from complete extinction in the wild. The scimitar-horned oryx is currently rated as endangered, but the population used to be in far worse shape. This antelope, originally native to the Sahara and Sahel regions of Africa, once numbered in the hundreds of thousands. But thanks to human disturbance, overhunting, and loss of food due to livestock grazing, oryx populations dwindled down to nothing. The oryx was officially declared extinct in the wild in the year 2000. But before its extinction, groups such as Sahara Conservation and Environment Agency of Abu Dhabi developed an ambitious plan for a globe-spanning world herd. The idea was to gather the few remaining oryx and disperse them to zoos all over the globe. There, they could breed the oryxes to increase their numbers, with the goal of eventually releasing them back to a protected swath of land. And that is exactly what the organizations did. Some of those oryxes do live in zoos and wildlife centers, but a significant number ended up in an unlikely place: private Texas ranches. These ranches have helped preserve the oryx populations, but not always for altruistic reasons. Some ranchers offer exotic hunts, much to the ire of conservationists. But in order to make sure that there would be large enough populations for hunters, ranchers had to make sure that the oryxes were breeding and that their populations were growing. Thanks to this care, the number of captive oryxes in Texas is now in the thousands. Along with the oryxes in zoos and wildlife centers, that's a population large enough to support reintroduction. A couple hundred of the animals were released in Chad in 2016, and other organizations have released them in other African countries. As of 2023, there are an estimated 600 oryxes living in the wild, enough to take the population from extinct to Endangered. The success of the Orex project has led to similar ones being developed for other critically endangered Saharan species, like the Adax and Dama gazelle. All of these conservation projects were long shots when they began. You don't exactly expect to bring back an animal that has literally gone extinct. But thanks to science and some ridiculously dedicated human beings, we are learning that insurance populations can save many endangered species, even after they are long gone from the wild. This video was inspired by the episodes from Wild Hope, like the frog arc about Panamanian frogs, and One Golden Chance, about the story behind the golden lion tamarind recovery. You can watch those episodes now and many more from Wild Hope right here on YouTube, or you can follow at Wild Hope TV on Instagram to discover countless more stories of changemakers working to restore biodiversity around the globe. Change is closer than you think.